Hey gang, in this week's episode of Snowmobiler Television, I'm at MBRP making noise and power with their pipes. Phil checked out some vintage oval racing, and we get our RTX Sidewinder on the snow. Boom.
STV is sponsored by Yamaha, revs your heart. Kimpex, fueled by fun. And by CKX, wear your passion.
Hey gang, we're in Huntsville, Ontario. We're at the MBRP World Sprawling Headquarters where all the magic happens for all the exhausts with Jared Heschka. You want to say Gesundheit?
Gesundheit.
Just kidding. There you go. Power Sports brand manager. And he's going to show us how they make the magic with the pipes and everything else you got going on here today, right?
You bet. Yeah, you guys know we're the experts in taking the hot air from the engine out the back. Making it sound cool.
You make it sound cool. Hot air in, out.
Yeah.
So you guys started with, that's been 21 years now, right?
21 years. Just marked 21 years.
But today we're going to talk about power sports.
Yep.
Because we're power sports guys. We're snowmobilers. And you got some new products that we want to touch on. And you also got some stuff for the side-by-side market as well. But let's talk about the sled stuff first. So what do you got cooking?
So we got actually a Skidoo 800 E-Tech sitting here right now. It's equipped with our race can. Something like this, you're going to see a couple extra horsepower gain. Everything is dyno tested. It's flow benched for proper back pressure. So you're not going to get any engine lights, bogging, any of that sort of stuff. But this guy here, it's actually going to save you about 14 pounds in weight.
So that's significant.
It's huge. I mean, and guys can truly appreciate even just how much easier it is, to work on the sled and just to access anything like the chain case or the battery or something like that. So,
a project like this or any of your projects, take me through the process from step one. Kind of, you get a new sled in, or you get a new diesel truck in. You guys do everything right here in-house, right?
Yep, everything's done in here. So basically, you get the sled in, we'll put it up on our sled hoist, get the guys to remove the stock exhaust. And how we actually build a jig, or basically a starting point, is we take it off, we'll spray like a white coating on it, and we 3D scan that. So basically, it pulls up like on a CAD drawing that how to kind of start off with a prototype. So once we get a first prototype built, we actually use all of our brackets will then be laser cut. So then there's a guaranteed fitment. Once we have a jig built that'll fit the prototype, we then go into production.
Your primary goal here, first and foremost though, is power. We're making some performance, because we're standing in the dyno room and you've got a dyno for cars, trucks, you're putting your side-by-sides on the dynos, you got a sled dyno over there and a smaller ATV dyno.
Yep.
What? Tell me kind of the process and what your goals are when you're designing an exhaust system or a silencer.
All right, so something like this, I mean, ultimately it's performance sound and also to get a power gain out of it. We'll test anywhere from 5 to 7 alterations of exhaust per unit.
Per
so
vehicle.
Like this, per this sled here, we'll change, inlet, outlet pipes, we'll change perforated cores, anything to kind of work with the flow differently, to make sure the sled not only runs appropriately, but it's a reliable and you get good sound.
Now I know you get two silencers here. These are both for snowmobile.
Yep.
What model are these for?
So these cans here are actually for a Polaris Axis at 800. So the difference you're really going to find here is we brought out the trail can in order to kind of meet like a 96 decibel reading at 4,000 RPM.
So give me an example. 86. So I want to talk about that. You've got the trail can, obviously a quieter can designed, for the trail.
Yep.
And we don't want to make it obnoxious or loud and cause trail closures. How does this, what's the decibel you said?
86 at 4,000 RPM.
So how does that compare to what a stock can is like?
Stock, you're going to be anywhere from about 4 to 6 over stock at
decibels.
At that RPM level.
So it's a tolerable, nice
exactly.
Vehicle.
And then, when you're kind of like a wide open throttle, you really want to ride aggressively, you'll definitely get that good bark. But a lot of the comments I've received is, it kind of gives me that snap when I want it, but when I kind of want to cruise with my buddies for the day, it's the can to go with.
And this can fits the same vehicle, obviously smaller, lighter.
Right.
This, I'm assuming, is something for the backcountry,
mountain guys, like anything basically. It's almost a safety thing, too. I mean, if you're riding with 4 and 5 guys and you've got a race can on your sled, you can hear him like one or two hills over that either A, he's stuck, or
where
B, he's still riding.
Right.
Yeah.
What's the weight savings on something like this?
Something like this, you're going to save about 9 pounds, and then this guy will move you up to about 13. So,
right on. Yeah. That's significant.
Yeah, very significant.
And these are finished. I know you talked about you have three different kinds of, they're not finishes, excuse me. This is types of materials.
Yeah.
This is, what kind of material is this?
This would be a 304 polished stainless. So that's how actually all of our cans come.
304 polished stainless. Ta-da.
There we go. He's, there we go. And
but then, this is not a coating. This is the actual material.
That is the actual material.
So
you'll notice even too, like over time, the cans will kind of turn like a little bit of a gold color. Not to fret, that can easily be polished. So there's no coating you're going to scratch off or anything like that. And just to point out quickly too, these brackets here are again laser cut, as you can see. Those are a guaranteed fitment.
You've got some head pipes here too. So aside from silencers, you're making some header pipes.
Correct.
Four sleds as well. This is for, I believe you told me, a Ski-Doo?
Yep, a Ski-Doo 900 Ace is what this guy's for here. So we get all of its 304 stainless, guaranteed.
I mean, it's a really nice piece.
Yeah.
And are you seeing power gains with this header pipe
You'll
as well?
You'll see a couple extra horsepower. And that's a pretty good gain, especially on something like a 900 Ace. And then when you pair it with our pipe, you're going to see anywhere from about a 5 to 6. Horsepower gain as well.
And is there a weight savings with these header pipes as well, or are they more on par?
They're more on par for the header pipes, yeah.
You offer header pipes for a lot of four-stroke applications for sleds, right?
Yep, we do the Ski-Doo, the 1200, the older XR chassis, as well as the newer XS chassis that we've just released as well, too.
And then the Viper, I'm assuming?
Viper as well, too. And then for 2017-2018 season, we're going to be offering the Sidewinder.
Phew, that's where we want it, baby.
Oh, yeah.
That's power. What do we got here?
This is actually our newer side-by-side system for the Polaris General. So that guy there, we've spent a lot of design time developing systems like these because, you know, newer bikes with the fuel systems and everything, we want to get away from customers having to buy something, like invest something like this, and then have to go buy something afterwards, like a fuel program or a tune. So the nice thing is having the, you know, resources such as our dyno or our flow bench that we can make sure there's sufficient back pressure that they're not going to need to go out and purchase a fuel pump.
The craftsmanship on these things is, I mean, it's top shelf. They're hand fabricated, but you're also using laser cutting, 3D scanning. So it's kind of combining the best technology with kind of that old school hands-on craftsmanship.
Exactly, yeah. And we're, you know, we're very fortunate, like since we're so heavily invested in automotive, we have, you know, a lot of these resources to do so and offer it at a very effective price point. You know, like, you know, you can offer it at $299 Canadian for a trail can or $279 for a race can Canadian as well too, or, you know, $269 US. So it's a very, we've been able to hit a really good price point with that. And again, you know, we can definitely appreciate the craftsmanship that our team does.
I want to take all those home with me.
Yeah.
Okay. So somewhere between here and there, we're just going to stick it in my duffel bag. Jared, thanks so much for showing me around the MBR headquarters.
You're welcome. It's a pleasure having you guys here.
Cool stuff. You guys build it all in-house, hand fabricated. I like it so much, I'm taking this one home with me.
I kind of gathered that.
We're going to put it on our 800 access and give it a rip. And speaking of rips, let's grab some helmets and take this can of ammo.
Yeah, want to go for a ride.
I'm game.
Perfect.
Hey, backing up a trailer isn't always easy, but Ford has made it easy for everyone with the Pro Trailer Backup Assist. We're going to visit with them today and find out how they did it. Mike, good to meet you.
Likewise.
Thanks for coming down.
Not a worry.
Impressive truck. I have one, not as nice as this one though. But I want to learn about the Pro Trailer Backup Assist and how we can take anybody, jump into this trailer and back it up in any nook and cranny, correct?
It's what I would say an augmentation of your skill level. So if you're a raw beginner, it'll move you more to the intermediate phase. If you're an intermediate, you can back it up like a pro. So you still need to have a basic understanding of how a trailer is going to behave.
Sure.
But you'll find that it just simplifies the whole process, takes the stress off and whenever you got that trailer backing up.
So, I mean, the truck's equipped with the system, but obviously not everyone has the same kind of trailer. So how do you mate the truck and the trailer together for the system to operate?
Okay. So the system works by taking four key measurements, and then it works with the power steering in the truck and the computer in the truck to figure out exactly what the maximum turns and sort of how the trailer is going to behave. So we can do 4 simple measurements. We input that into the truck itself. The trailer stores up to 10 different trailers. You can name the trailer, make sure that you've got the right trailer, and it also, that way you don't have to re-enter your data every time, and you also get to keep track of miles.
Talking about Pat's trailer, Mike's trailer,
absolutely.
Same truck.
Absolutely.
So the setup is relatively easy though? Doesn't take a lot of time?
It takes about 4 minutes to do.
Let's do it.
All right.
The stickers install, what other measurements do we have to take?
Okay, so there's a couple measurements we need to do. The first one is from the license plate to the center of the ball.
All right.
And you're going to record these numbers, and then I'm assuming later we're going to plug those into the system.
Yep.
So we're at 27 centimeters on this one.
Perfect. So next we're going to measure from the center of the ball to the center of the sticker.
Okay. And that's going to be 36.
All right. And then the next one, we're going to go from the rear view camera, mounted right under the tailgate there, to the center of the sticker.
93 centimeters.
Now the last one we're going to do is actually measuring from the edge of the bumper to the middle of, since this is a tandem axle, to the middle of the tandem axle.
So I'll hold the tape up here.
You know, Mike, being an American, these numbers are really big when you get to centimeters. Everything's so huge. I'm saying 633 centimeters.
All right, perfect.
Oh, I love that new truck smell. You get to drive this every day?
When I'm lucky.
You are the man. All right, so we've got our measurements. What's the next step?
Okay, so if you want to turn the truck on.
Start it up?
Yep.
Oh, we're going for a ride. Right on.
We can just use the steering wheel controls, enter the data as we recorded it. So now the only thing it's going to ask you to do is to go for a quick drive, just to calibrate it.
Okay. Then we're ready to roll. There we go. Calibration complete.
Okay. So now you're all set up and ready to use Pro Trailer Backup Assist.
Awesome. Well, let's take it back down to where we've got some elements set up and see how accurate and how we can become a pro.
Perfect.
All right, Mike, so we've got the trailer programmed into the system. We've pulled up in front of the MBRP garage. There's like 3 very expensive Ford vehicles behind me, and there's 3 expensive snowmobiles to the left of me, and you want me to back this trailer in alongside all of that.
We're gonna test your skills.
Oh boy. Okay, so how do we turn on the system?
As simple as throwing the truck in reverse.
Okay.
And then push the knob for the Pro Trailer Backup Assist.
Right,
so it's
here.
On.
Yep.
And then it's gonna ask you to confirm which trailer you've got.
All right, there's the OSM trailer.
So basically all you're gonna do is control the trailer now through that knob only.
Through this knob here.
That's it.
And if I happen to touch the steering wheel, what happens? It just disengages the system?
Just disengages the system. You can reactivate it when you choose to. And so what this technology does is essentially lets you steer from the perspective of the trailer. So if you want the trailer to turn to the left, turn the knob to the left, and vice versa. The right. So a couple other little things to keep in mind. Slow, gentle movements are going to be your benefit. You can turn the knob, if you have an aggressive turn, you can turn the knob all the way. The trailer will not jackknife. The system is programmed to avoid that.
Nice.
And once the trailer is on the plane of where you want it to go, just take your hand off the knob. It'll straighten the truck out to the trailer and keep that trailer going in a straight line backwards.
Okay, and it's important to point out, we've kind of messed with this a little bit already, but you still control the speed and the stopping with your feet. I mean, it doesn't do everything. It's basically controlling the steering of the trailer.
Absolutely.
Right. All right, well, we've got expensive stuff back there. Let's see how it goes. So I'll just start stepping on the gas here a little bit, and I am going to turn the knob the direction I want the trailer to go. And we've got to make here a pretty sharp right-hand corner. And I'm going to be ginger about it, because I don't want to hit anything. So I made part of the turn. Am I going to come? And I'm just getting by the Ford back there, which looked pretty expensive, Mike. I'll be honest. I would be doing this by hand.
And that's the whole purpose of the system, is to give you the confidence to get the trailer where you need it, when you need it there.
Now we're getting there. We've made the turn. Now I'm going to try to line this thing up right alongside the building. And now I'm in my spot. I can let go. Look at that. I'd let my wife back this thing up, Mike. And there we are. We're in.
Like a pro.
And as you can see, I did not hit Martin's focus. Thank goodness. He's got a little money in there.
Or the sleds.
Or the sleds. Or the F-450. Or the F-150. We made it in here perfectly safe and sound. Like a pro.
Are you Starsky or Hutch?
Both.
Well, there was a bunch of fine lads that we all got together and we had a vision to get Ontario Racing going again, and we wanted to make it happen. So we made some phone calls, we had some good conversations, and then we decided to call a meeting in the spring, and over lots of time and effort, we did shows, we did presentations, and we organized with tracks to make this happen, and negotiations, and here we are today, and it's happening. The weather isn't the greatest, but we're getting the day in. Last night was a restless sleep, had a lot on my mind. This is new for a lot of us to get together to do this, but we can't let it stop us. We know there's gonna be little hurdles, little bumps along the way, but we can't let those stop us. If we want to be successful with this, we need to push through them. We need to work together as a team and the racers. The racers have been really great today with exercising caution around the track and patience to make this all happen. And we're working through it. It's working.
That's what we all want. We all want the old days. We remember it was. I raced back in 78. I was at Kawartha Cup in 72. I loved it back then. It was huge. Every small town that had a snow carnival had a snowmobile race. Nowadays, the last year, there's two snowmobile races in all of Ontario. So we're changing that. We're getting more races for everybody. It's beautiful seeing a race happen. I'd love to see a second day happen too. We're certainly hoping on that. But so far, I'm glad of all the turnout and the spectators. And the support. We're very, very fortunate that there's so many people waiting for this to happen, and finally here we are.
It's impressive. This has been a sort of a short run, but it's been a tough run to get to this point, but it's been awesome. And lots of support, lots of people out. The weather was a little scary at the beginning, but it's working out well. We want this under our belts. People can see that we can do this, and it doesn't cost a fortune, so let's get out here and have fun.
This year, I was really excited to get this Sidewinder out on the trails. But before I got to take it out, Pat Bourgeois did some add-ons from front to back. Pat and I don't agree on much. In fact, we agree on very little, except tall windshields. And I'm so glad Pat put this on, because when you're falling on the sleds and there's chunks of snow or really cold wind, I like this, so does Pat. We actually agree on something. Wow, Pat did a great job of putting this bumper on. Not only is it solid, he's also got the skid plate underneath, and it came in handy going through snowbanks and hopefully not going off the trail. This thing was solid. Pat's done a great job. I know I hit a couple ice chunks there that fell off the groomer. Super solid. It helped out on this ride. Three more extra things that Pat added for me were the windshield bag, the hand guards, and the riser. The windshield bag is handy for putting things in there that you don't want bouncing around in other luggage areas. The hand guards, they're great for following those sleds and those ice chunks come off, and instead of hitting you in the knuckles, they bounce off, you don't feel them. And the riser, it's great when you're riding along, cruising on the smooth trails, and when you hit that side trail with some moguls, just adjust it, up it comes, lock it, and you're ready to take those all in for that rougher part of the trail. Thanks, Pat. At the back of the sled, Pat did me another favor, adding in lots of luggage. Now here's a little trick I do when I travel. I use my helmet bag as my clothing bag so I can put it in there and it all stays together so you're not walking around with all kinds of clothes falling out in the lobby. And to show you how big it is, that's the helmet bag. Look how much space Pat gave me. Over here, more luggage for all my tripods and camera mounts. Pat did a great job. Pat, thanks so much for busting yourself to get this sled ready for my tour. I hope you're having fun in the office.
Hi everybody, we're outside today and it's been a little wonky this year. It's been a little mild, then a little cold, resulting in some icy trails, so a little slippery in the corners. So today we're going to talk about traction products. And Jeremy, you remember the old days of cleated tracks? We'd have to put these claws and bar claws in there, and things have changed today. What are our options for staying safe on the trails in the ice?
Well, things have definitely evolved, Phil. You know, from the days of the old cat claws and studs that were T-nuts and pushed, you know, nowadays we got a push-through type stud, which basically is a type of stud that you drill through your track, push through, put a big washer on the outside and put a nut on it. But there's also more products available, such as some of the stuff we've got here. What we've got is a new color-coordinated claw type product, which allows you to basically screw your stud into it, giving you a more aggressive traction as well as better handling.
So this is a much better way of putting the studs on, much more colorful, but also much more practical in weight, and also the way that they hold on, no more pulling through?
That's right. It eliminates a lot of pull-through type situations, but there is other stuff available as well.
Right, let's show us what else people can do for their tracks.
iGrip produces a product which allows you to screw into the lug of the track and allows you for an ice ripper type track. Which basically gives you a small stud that screws right into the lug.
So we've gone from the old days of big old steel cleats, which added a lot of weight, to push-through type studs, to screw-ins. So there's a lot of choices from Kimpex.
There is. So you got to go to kimpex.com and see what you got that works for your sled.
And get some traction.
STV is sponsored by Yamaha, revs your heart. Kimpex, fueled by fun. And by CKX, wear your passion.
Well, that does it for this week's episode. Phil, you made those vintage sleds look young again.
Well, we are kind of vintage, both of us, but I gotta tell you, if you'd been there, you'd have bought everything and hauled it back. It would have cost you a fortune, but you wanted everything that was there.
How's making power with MBRP? Just tell the kids where they get more information.
Go to snowbuildertv.com or osmmag.com.
Till next week, boom.
I think it's Ooga Booga time. Hello, children, it's Uncle Bobby.